Join us for installment number 3 of the popular Roadside Adventures series, Adirondacks Rest in Peace. True stories of the famous and the not-so-famous who died for causes they believed in. And in a few cases, just died because, well, it was their time to go. Anyway, we'll tell you their remarkable life stories and then pay a visit to their final resting places in the Adirondack Mountains of far upstate New York. In this episode, we'll visit the graves of two sworn enemies, one who fought for the British and the other who fought for the Americans at the Battle of Plattsburgh near the end of the War of 1812. Now, victor and vanquished lie side by side in peace for all eternity. And we'll tell you the story of a smart, beautiful, and wealthy young woman who summered in the Adirondacks with her family until the women's suffrage movement launched her into the national spotlight. But this woman's unrelenting struggle for women's rights would prove to be too much, and she would die proclaiming, "Mr. President, how long must women wait for liberty?" Today, a visit to her grave in the Adirondacks, almost 100 years after her passing, continues to inspire the cause.
Giddy up, Roadside!
Production of Roadside Adventures is made possible in part by
the Adirondack Coast. Less than an hour south of downtown Montreal lies beautiful Lake Champlain, pristine beaches, historic forts, museums, rich agriculture, shopping, and our famous Adirondack hospitality. The Adirondack Coast. Escape the everyday.
Liquor and Wine Warehouse, featuring a wide selection of adult beverages and a friendly and knowledgeable staff. Located in the Four Seasons Plaza across from the Ground Round, open 7 days a week.
Northline Utilities. At Northline Utilities, we create employment and training opportunities for North Country residents through projects that build community and social infrastructure. Family-focused and education-oriented, power is our business, and pride is our choice.
And by viewers like you.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of Roadside Adventures. I'm Derek Muirden. You know, from time to time on this series, we've done a very popular show called Adirondack RIP, or Rest in Peace. And we've heard feedback from you to do some more. So here we go with Roadside Adventures Adirondack Rest in Peace, Episode 3. And it begins right here in Riverside Cemetery, the first municipal cemetery of Plattsburgh, New York. Now, Plattsburgh is on the northern edge of the Adirondacks along the western shores of Lake Champlain. And right here on the water and the land, way back during the War of 1812, something happened here that would change the course of history. Take a look. The War of 1812 was a 2.5-year struggle between America and Britain. It was declared by the Americans, who did not appreciate the British attempts to keep European goods from reaching America, nor the ongoing effort by Britain to supply the indigenous American Indian tribes with guns and ammunition and plenty of encouragement to stop, with force if necessary, any attempts at expansion by the Americans. In September of 1814, the Battle of Plattsburgh ended the last British attempt to push south through the northernmost boundaries of America. Things came to a head in and near Plattsburgh, New York, on the western shores of Lake Champlain on the morning of September 11th, when the British Army Lieutenant General George Prevost attacked by land and a British Navy squadron under Captain George Downie attacked from the water. Cannon to cannon, musket to musket, the great warships, the smaller gunboats, and the armies on land slugged it out. When the smoke literally cleared, Downie was dead, with the British squadron in tatters. Sir George Prevost struck the British colors, signaling defeat. But there was no time for celebration by the Americans because there were dead and wounded everywhere. So one of the first orders given by the United States Master Commandant Thomas McDonough in his victory was to bury the dead, all of the dead, British and American alike. Now, Keith Herkelow is the guy I'm looking for in the cemetery today. He's not only a reenactor and a historian, but he's also an author, written a very interesting book about Plattsburgh and the War of 1812. And he's going to show us some of the, well, skeletons that are buried here, if I may.
Good afternoon.
Hello, Keith.
Mr. Morgan, how are you?
I'm great. I love your outfit. Are you reenacting somebody?
Yes, I'm portraying Sailmaster Brum, United States Navy, under the command of Thomas McDonough, the overall fleet commander at Plattsburgh.
On which ship?
On the Saratoga.
On the Saratoga.
That's correct, sir.
Which was here at the battle.
Absolutely.
So what did this guy do?
Sailmaster Brum was, his job was to control the deck at the orders of Thomas McDonough. Well, during the battle, after 2 hours and 15 minutes of battle, Thomas McDonough ordered his ship to be wound.
What does that mean?
Turned around.
Now, do you do that with sails and the wind and it?
No, this was at anchor, Derek.
Really?
Yes, and if the anchors are set in opposing corners and they're tied around the capstan, the big roll in the middle of the deck, then if the crew, under the command of Mr. Brum, orders them to wind the ship, it turns around, and now suddenly there are 19 fresh guns.
Boom, just like that, looking right at the British.
That's correct.
What happened?
After that volley was fired, the British, who were listing and taking on water at that point anyway, after 2 hours and 15 minutes of battle, regarded that as being a pivotal moment. And they decided to strike their color, a signal victory for the United States.
So that is when the United States won the Battle of Plattsburgh.
Essentially, that's correct.
Right?
This was one of the most important victories in United States history.
Now, right here in Riverside Cemetery, the American commander said, actually put out an order, that for their valor, all the British officers would be buried with the American officers.
That's correct.
That there would be no disrespect.
No disrespect.
And so we've got a really interesting thing here we want to show you. And I think one of the first things is the grave that's right over here, because this is, after all, the British commander, right?
Yes. This is the grave of George Downie. George Downie was the station chief and captain of the naval fleet of Britain here
British,
at Plattsburgh.
Yeah.
Yes, on Lake Champlain.
The Confiance.
Yes, that was his flagship.
Now, was this the guy that was killed in the first 15 minutes of the battle?
Yes, it was.
How did that happen?
He suffered a wound that was really unusual in this case, because one of the cannonballs fired from the American ship Saratoga hit the muzzle of the cannon in which he was standing behind.
No.
And it crushed him.
The cannon just went back.
That's correct.
And that cannon now, the damaged cannon, is kind of a talisman for American sailors, isn't it?
Yes.
And it still exists. Where is it?
It still exists, and it's outside McDonough Hall at Annapolis, the U.S. Naval Academy.
A little motivation for all the plebs.
Absolutely.
Now, why is Downie buried here in the middle of a municipal cemetery?
Thomas McDonough and Alexander McComb honored the bravery of the individuals who fought. And they were enemies in battle, but they were friends in death.
Amazing. You know, that's just amazing. And all around here are officers of
yes.
both armies,
mm-hmm.
and there's two over here that I gotta show you because it just gives me goosebumps.
Now, Derek, we're surrounded by the 15 officers mm-hmm. who fell here at Plattsburgh. Mm-hmm. And here's a perfect example of what I was speaking of
oh,
before.
Oh yeah, look at this.
Lieutenant Runk of the United States Army.
Yeah.
He fell on September the 8th.
And right here, right next to him.
Right next to him in the same time frame as Colonel Willington of the 3rd Regiment of Buffs.
Look
British
at that.
And American.
2 feet apart.
2 feet apart.
For all eternity. What a lesson that is in honor and respect. What a lesson it is in the futility of war, if I may.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about all of this particular part of this cemetery and all of that I just mentioned in your book, your
yes,
new
sir.
Book.
Thank you.
What's the name of the book?
The Battles at Plattsburgh, September 11, 1814.
Yeah, good read. If you want to read about this stuff, that's an excellent book. There's another story, another really sad piece of American history in the Old Post Cemetery just down the road, right?
That is correct.
And you're the guy that knows all about that.
Well, I think I do.
Okay, lead on.
Let's go.
This small bit of land shaded by towering pines has served as a cemetery for all the Army forts as well as the Air Force base which once surrounded it. From a Civil War barracks and training grounds to a key Army post during World War I, II, and the Korean conflict. The Old Base Cemetery, as it came to be called, kept its gate open to the fallen in all those conflicts, as well as for the military dependents, the sons and daughters, husbands and wives, as well as the fully retired. Today, the cemetery is closed to further burials, but open to anyone who wishes to come and pay their respects. But few visitors know that the Old Base Cemetery holds a dark yet noble secret.
Well, Derek, this is known as the Old Post Cemetery. There are bodies here of soldiers who fought in the War of 1812.
But the cemetery opened so much later.
Yes. Well, the graves were discovered in other portions of the base here, of the post at
uh-huh,
the time,
uh-huh.
and they were disinterred and all buried right here and just beyond us in the graves ahead of us. And this is a monument to the unknowns in the War of 1812. And this is the first monument that we're aware of to any unknown soldiers, and it was authorized by the Secretary of the War.
You mean, let me interrupt right there. Any unknown soldier in American history?
That's correct.
This is the first monument erected.
Authorized by the United States government.
Got it.
And for instance, the Tomb of the Unknowns in Washington was 1931.
And this is what?
This was 1888.
And it says erected to the memory of unknown soldiers and sailors of the War of 1812, killed in action or dying of wounds
received
on the
battle
of Plattsburgh. But this is not a tomb. There's no one buried here.
Nope, not in or underneath this particular monument.
So where are they? Where are the unknowns buried?
The burials are what you see beyond you here
oh.
are markers of the graves of the remains of 91 soldiers found near Fort Scott. There are some to the rear of us now, but the majority of them were first buried in this portion of the cemetery here.
Now, Fort Scott was just down the road here.
Just down the road, one of the three forts that existed.
During the
battles at Plattsburgh.
At the War of 1812.
That's correct.
Got it. So if you really want to feel that visceral feeling that people died, it isn't just the officers that we saw at the previous cemetery.
That's correct.
You got to come here because these are all
enlisted
people.
That's correct.
Another question I have, Keith, is earlier we saw really cozy, if you will, individual graves for officers, but here the enlisted are all clumped together. Why is that?
Well, there were many more enlisted than there were officers, number one.
Right.
Number two, most of the gentlemen couldn't read or write.
Most of these guys,
but the officers, many of them kept journals. They kept in touch with their families with letters.
They would have their names sewn to the inside of their uniforms?
More than likely, they had servants to attend them,
right.
usually. In this particular case, most of the enlisted did not have that luxury, and they were common, if you want to call it that. None less do the option of being honored. We have 116 unknowns here in this location.
Amazing. So it's the tombs, plural.
Yes.
Of the unknown.
That's correct.
That's fascinating.
It is fascinating.
That's just fascinating.
Another piece of American history, sometimes forgotten, if, as we say, but rest in peace.
Rest in peace, exactly. I think you'll admit that that is one tiny little cemetery, but I also think you'll admit that it is certainly packed with American history. Well, now on to part two of this Roadside Adventure Adirondack Rest in Peace number three. And that brings us to this cemetery in Lewis, New York, about 45 minutes south of Plattsburgh. We're at the Congregational Church of Lewis, New York. And buried in this cemetery is one of the iconic soldiers in the fight for women's suffrage. Inez Milholland was born into a Brooklyn, New York family in 1886. She grew up smart, beautiful, and wealthy. Inez and her family spent their summers here at their Adirondack Great Camp in Lewis, New York. By the time she got to college, Inez had become greatly influenced by the women's movement in America. Encouraged by her family, Inez became an active member in the struggle for women's suffrage, particularly in gaining women the right to vote. In 1913, dressed in white, wearing a gold crown, and mounted on a silvery white steed, Inez led the women's suffrage parade down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C., on the eve of President Wilson's inauguration. Thousands of women and the men who supported their cause marched that day, but it was Inez Milholland at the lead who became the unforgettable symbol for women's rights. This photograph appeared in almost every newspaper in the country, and soon Inez was being asked to speak at suffrage rallies everywhere. On a trip to London to speak there, she met and soon married a wealthy Dutch businessman named Eugene John Boissevain. It was Inez, by the way, who did the proposing, three times, in fact, before Boissevain said yes. Back in America, Inez immersed herself in the cause, traveling coast to coast on speaking tours designed to bring pressures to bear on the President of the United States to create a 19th Amendment to the Constitution, giving women the right to vote. In 1916, on a westward speaking tour, Inez's demanding schedule started taking a toll on her health. Despite admonitions of her family to slow down, Inez kept to her busy schedule. On October 22, 1916, in the middle of a speech in Los Angeles, Inez collapsed. She was rushed to a nearby hospital, but despite the best treatments of the day, Inez died 4 weeks later. The cause of her death was pernicious anemia, a blood disease. Milholland's last public words were reported to be, "Mr. President, how long must women wait for liberty?" Inez Milholland was just 30 years old. Inez's body was brought back to the summer home here in Lewis. And shortly thereafter, there was a funeral at the Congregational Church, after which her body was carried up this long road to the very crown of the hill where she was laid to rest. To be sure, Inez Milholland was dead. But the battle raged on. Sandra Weber is a prolific author of books and articles for both children and adults. Her life as an avid hiker, explorer, historian, writer, and keen observer keep her very busy. Especially in demand are her lectures and readings from her book, Breaking Trail, Remarkable Women of the Adirondacks. In it, she writes extensively about Inez Milholland's contributions to women's rights and liberties.
Derek, this is the Milholland family burial plot.
Way up on top of the hill overlooking the valley and the church below. This
yes.
is wow, look at these big stones here.
And this is Inez Milholland and her father, John.
And Inez is, it doesn't say Milholland, it just simply says Inez.
Because Inez is how the whole world knew her for 30 years.
How does a 30-year-old fire up so many people for such a cause?
Her father and her family taught her that even though she came from a place of wealth, that social causes and the well-being of other people is very important. And she fought for those social causes all of her life. And she came to believe that the women's cause was the most important of all.
If she could talk to us right now, what do you think, what kind of encouragement would she give us as far as continuing the fight?
There is still a fight to carry on, and she is here with us today. She's here. Mm-hmm. And she's encouraging women and men to open their eyes and to carry on the fight and to make this a better world for men and women.
Don't give up the fight.
Don't ever give up the fight.
And that's really her legacy, isn't it?
Yes. And remember those that have battled to get where we are today.
Are those for Inez?
Yes, they are.
Go ahead, please.
The stone will perish. I shall be twice dust. Only my standard on a taken hill can cheat the mildew and the red-brown rust and make immortal my adventurous will. Even now the silk is tugging at the staff. Take up the song, forget the epitaph.
In May of 1919, President Wilson called a special session of Congress. On the 20th of that month, a bill introducing the 19th Amendment to the Constitution passed both the House and Senate. A year later, the amendment became law when the necessary amount of states, 35 of them, ratified the amendment. The first sentence of the 19th Amendment states in simple and plain language that which Inez Milholland and thousands of women had fought long and hard for, the right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. It was done, but greater struggles for women's rights lay ahead, like the one that would have kept Inez Milholland Boissevain from casting her ballot. You see, a law at the time prohibited American citizens who married foreigners from voting.
Production of Roadside Adventures is made possible in part by
the Adirondack Coast. Less than an hour south of downtown Montreal lies beautiful Lake Champlain. Pristine beaches, historic forts, museums, rich agriculture, shopping, and our famous Adirondack hospitality. The Adirondack Coast. Escape the everyday.
Liquor and Wine Warehouse, featuring a wide selection of adult beverages and a friendly and knowledgeable staff. Located in the Four Seasons Plaza across from the Ground Round. Open 7 days a week.
Northline Utilities. At Northline Utilities, we create employment and training opportunities for North Country residents through projects that build community and social infrastructure. Family-focused and education-oriented, power is our business, and pride is our choice.
And by viewers like you.
You know, we get a big kick out of doing these Adirondack Rest in Peace shows inside the Roadside Adventure series. We hope you enjoy them and that you find them informative. The one thing that we do ask, though, that if you strike out on your own or follow in our footsteps, that you just take pictures and try not to leave too many footprints. For videographer Daniel McCullum, I'm Derek Muirden, saying thanks for watching, and we'll see you again when we head out down the road in search of another roadside adventure.
The program you just watched is available on DVD for $14.95 plus shipping and handling. To order your copy, call 1-800-836-5700. Order online at mountainlake.org or write to the address on your screen. New York State residents at applicable sales tax.